Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Beats, a very short introduction by David Sterritt, narrated by James Conlan.
Chapter 1. Origins and Essences. In the late 1950s and early 60s, a small group of writers challenged long-accepted tenets of American literature with their iconoclastic approach to language and their angry assault on the conformity and conservatism of postwar society. As originators and role models of what came to be called the Beat Generation, they took aim at the hypocrisy and taboos of their time, particularly those involving sex, race, and class, in such provocative works as Jack Kerouac's On the Road, 1957, Allen Ginsberg's Howl, 1956, and William S. Burroughs's Naked Lunch, 1959. Although they were a loosely knit collective rather than an organized movement, the Beats shared a deeply felt disappointment with the shallowness and acquisitiveness of American culture. This disaffection catalyzed their search for more artistically and spiritually attuned ways of thinking, living, and creating. Frequently inflected by Eastern religion, these found expression in lifestyles and artworks that celebrated rootlessness, rebellion, introspection, and spontaneity. As their activities became more widely known, the Beats were imitated by other restive youths and scorned by mainstream voices that found nothing to admire in a scruffy subculture steeped in sex, drugs, and metaphysics. But such attacks only added to the Beats' prominence, allowing them to flummox stereotypes, as when Kerouac said that he rejected mutiny and insurrection, standing instead for order, tenderness, and piety, and making them a hotly contested symbol in the era's culture wars. Kerouac, Ginsberg, and Burroughs were the most famous Beat writers, followed by the poets Gregory Corso, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, Gary Snyder, and Diane de Prima, the hipsters Neal Cassady and Carolyn Cassady, and others less widely known. The places they lived in and wrote about ranged from Greenwich Village and San Francisco to Mexico, Western Europe, and North Africa. The subjects that fascinated them included drugs, music, sexuality, spirituality, and the urgency of finding what Ferlinghetti called a new rebirth of wonder in a jaded world. Although they were predominantly a white male group, a modest number of African-American writers and women can also be counted as members. De Prima and Ann Waldman have exerted considerable influence on American letters through their energetic contributions to Beat poetry and poetics, earning recognition for their political activism and pedagogical innovation, as well as literary excellence per se. Bob Kaufman was called the original bebop man during the years when he enlivened San Francisco streets and coffee houses with improvised poetry recitals, preferring not to record his verses on paper, but to perform them wherever an audience might gather. A more widely known African-American Beat is Amiri Baraka, who changed his name from Leroy Jones in 1967. After leaving military service in the middle 1950s, he lived in Greenwich Village, became acquainted with Beat writers and other progressive literary figures, and founded Totem Press, which published Kerouac, Ginsberg, and De Prima, among others. He also edited the little magazine Culture, and in partnership with De Prima, The Floating Bear. Celebrated and controversial as a poet, playwright, publisher, polemicist, professor, and militant, Baraka left a distinctive imprint on the Beat years and beyond. Members of the Beat Generation hoped that their radical rejection of consumerism, materialism, and regimentation would inspire others to purify their lives and souls as well. In this respect, their values anticipate those of subsequent protest movements, such as the anti-Vietnam War campaigns that crested in the 1970s and the Occupy Wall Street demonstrations of 2011. In contrast with political protesters, however, the Beats urged the remaking of consciousness on a profoundly inward-looking basis, cultivating the unspeakable visions of the individual, in Kerouac's vivid phrase. The idea was to revolutionize society by revolutionizing thought, not the other way around. The beat writers and their disciples challenged received wisdom by cultivating radical ideas and drastic styles, fending off absorption into mainstream culture, while inadvertently preparing ground for larger, more explosive social upheavals to come. Their influence waned as the hippie movement arose in the middle 1960s, but their impact can still be felt in literature, cinema, music, theater, and the visual arts. The Roaring 1920s, the Dirty 1930s. The Beats came of age in the World War II era, after living through the Great Depression, and the oldest of them, Burroughs, and the poet Herbert Hunky, remembered the 1920s from their childhoods. Kerouac came into the world in 1922, and no fewer than three important beat figures were born in the banner year of 1926, Ginsberg, Cassady, and the writer John Clellon Holmes, who was less a beat leader than a chief observer and chronicler of their exploits. The youngest major beats were Corso, born in 1930, Peter Orlovsky, born in 1933, and De Prima, born in 1934. The most direct literary forebears of the beats were the so-called Lost Generation writers, an informal gathering of Americans abroad named after a comment by Gertrude Stein, "You are all a lost generation," which Ernest Hemingway used as an epigraph in his first novel, The Sun Also Rises, published in 1926. The statement encapsulated the idea that World War I had prevented a whole generation of young men from having the civilizing experiences normal for people in their late teens and early 20s. Stumbling out of the most brutal conflict in history, they typically lacked direction, focus, and the sense of day-to-day purpose that their parents had, presumably, taken for granted. They were lost in an almost literal sense. By the late 1920s, the Lost Generation label was being applied less to demobilized European fighters than to the American writers who had started circulating in and around the left bank of Paris, attracted by the city's openness to high modernist culture and, just as important, its inexpensive cost of living, thanks to favorable foreign exchange rates. Paris also offered a refuge from the lingering influence of Victorian values in the United States, where prohibition and prudishness still reigned. The Americans in Paris were a diverse lot, ranging from the macho Hemingway to the vulnerable F. Scott Fitzgerald. Also present were such phenomenal avant-garde writers as Stein, T.S. Eliot, James Joyce, and Ezra Pound, as well as the adventurous publisher and bookseller Sylvia Beach. Lost they may have been, but they were amazingly productive, too, changing cultural paradigms with their innovative prose and poetry, their support for new journals like Ford Madox Ford's Transatlantic Review, and the conversations they shared while drinking away their nights and often their days in Montparnasse cafes. The 1920s lost their roar when inflated stock market prices abruptly crashed in 1929, bringing disastrous results to Americans and others as far away as Australia, where the next decade was dubbed the Dirty 30s. Conditions in America grew even worse in 1931, when drought and dirt-blowing black blizzards turned much of the country's southern and western agricultural land into a dust bowl plagued by poverty, sickness, and misery that persisted until 1939, when normal rain finally returned. Because of these awful circumstances and other factors, such as immigration from Europe and muckraking journalism, the 1930s sparked a good deal of progressive activity in the United States, including a fresh outpouring of labor union solidarity. Popular culture was lively as well, from Hollywood studios, where talkies drove out silent pictures, to comic strips, where Superman made his debut in the illustrious company of Crazy Cat, Buck Rogers, and other antic characters. Developments like these helped Americans keep a degree of optimism about the future. While some European and Asian countries turned to fascism and militarism for solutions, Americans hoped Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the new president elected in 1932, would pull things together with less extreme measures. Many viewed him as a closet socialist eager for government action on every front, but in reality, he was a closet conservative, using government as a tool for restoring social equilibrium and saving the tarnished reputations of capitalism and democracy. What ultimately rescued America from the Depression was World War II, which opened the way for government interventions that could be praised as patriotic necessity rather than feared as creeping socialism. The war effort put countless people back to work, and victory boosted American morale to its highest level in decades. The Less Than Fabulous 50s. America emerged from the war as the strongest power in the world. The economy boomed, powered by everything from the Marshall Plan abroad to the growth of credit card spending at home. Developers promoted neat suburban homes as nesting places for right-thinking families. New technologies made life easier and more fun, at least for the middle class, and the press overflowed with predictions of how harnessing the atom would bring even greater things in days to come. The nation's material well-being was not matched by feelings of psychological and spiritual health, however. The frequent use of terms like rat race and lonely crowd and organization man bespoke a nagging discomfort with side effects of the post-war economic boom. Conformity, explored in best-selling books like The Organization Man and The Man in the Gray Flannel Suit, was de rigueur. Conservatism was reflected by the two-time election of Republican war hero Dwight D. Eisenhower as U.S. president. Consumerism was fueled by the Madison Avenue advertising industry and the skyrocketing power of commercial television. Consensus prevailed over pluralism, encouraging agreement on supposedly self-evident values, while sweeping defects in the social order, often linked to inequalities of race, class, and gender, under the proverbial rug. Common sense usually meant believing what your friends and neighbors believed, not what intellectuals and eggheads said in fancy books. Cold War paranoia spawned McCarthyism, anti-communist witch hunts, and a sense of brooding dread about Soviet plans to destroy the free world with nuclear weapons. Uneasiness with these problems grew as the 1950s unfolded. The yawning gap between rich and poor refused to stop yawning. People borrowed too heavily and found themselves saddled with unnecessary debts. The manufacturing strategy of planned obsolescence kept consumers consuming by building limited lifespans into commercial items from toasters to automobiles, which duly broke down just when they were starting to seem indispensable. Many suburbs were so standardized that it was hard to tell one carefully manicured house and lawn from another. Even the popular President Eisenhower could not build the interstate highway system he dreamed of without selling it as a new and improved way of moving America's nuclear missiles to places where they might be needed when the Soviets attacked. The nation also harbored vicious racism, official in the southern states and subtler but still distressing in the northern ones. Kerouac figured out much of this early in his career. His instinctive skepticism shows through in his first novel, The Town and the City, completed in 1949. In one sociologically sophisticated passage, a character mutely gives his small-town Massachusetts neighbors a series of sardonic warnings. In God's name, don't fall out of line. Look out for that budget. Responsibilities to meet, you know. Love your wife and kitties. Learn to accept the whip of your next in rank. Don't revolt, whatever you do. This crystallizes the Beat's preference for dropping out of a corrupt system rather than passively participating in it. As for me, ladies and gentlemen, Kerouac's character concludes, I'm going to desert the sinking ship. Adjust, you must. Most people had no desire to jump ship, of course, and many pundits thought conformity was a benevolent force, easing the tensions and frictions of a complicated, fast-moving social order. But the idea of adjusting to society was troubling to thinkers who felt society should adjust to its citizens, not the other way around. The literary critic Maxwell Geismar wrote in 1954 that the arts of the Eisenhower era were swayed so strongly by social and intellectual conformity that superstition and ignorance had become the norm. Another skeptic was the sociologist William H. White, who coined the word groupthink in a 1952 essay for Fortune magazine. He argued that while conformity has been around forever, modern conformity is rationalized enough to become a genuine philosophy, defining the typical person as a creature of the environment rather than an individual capable of self-determination. These and other intellectuals wanted to warn modernized society against the dictatorship of other-directed behavior, to use David Riesman's term. A particularly articulate warning came in 1956 from Robert Lindner, a psychoanalyst who refused to follow party lines or buy into conventional paradigms. His condemnation of adjustment read in part, "You must adjust. This is the motto inscribed on the walls of every nursery, and the processes that break the spirit are initiated there. In birth begins conformity. You must adjust. This is the legend inscribed in every schoolbook, the invisible message on every blackboard. Our schools have become vast factories for the manufacture of robots. You must adjust. This is the command etched above the door of every church, synagogue, cathedral, temple, and chapel. You must adjust. This is the slogan emblazoned on the banners of all political parties. You must adjust. This is the creed of the sciences that have sold themselves to the status quo, the prescription against perplexity, the placebo for anxiety. For psychiatry, psychology, and the medical or social arts that depend from them have become devil's advocates and sorcerer's apprentices of conformity." Lindner's warning was clear. According to contemporary Kant, those who failed to adjust in the right ways might raise juvenile delinquents, see them flunk out of school, rub God the wrong way, vote for an unpatriotic party, and disappoint their psychoanalysts. A fearful litany of consequences for individuals who marched too insistently to their own drummers. Adjustment was pushed especially hard where matters of sex were concerned. Sexuality was heavily regulated by both law and custom during the 1950s. Homophobia was ubiquitous, although the word itself had not yet been invented, and heterosexuals were advised to save themselves for marriage. This meant in practice that young people plunged into marriage at earlier and earlier ages, only to become bored and restless in many cases, despite the lectures on togetherness they read in pop psychology magazines. Female fashions had a neo-Victorian air, calling for padded bras, curve-enhancing girdles, and high-heeled shoes that turned women's bodies into the equivalent of shielded citadels. While waiting for the right person to walk down the aisle with, one could watch family-worshipping TV shows on the order of Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver. Bolder sorts could peruse Alfred Kinsey's hugely publicized reports on male and female sexuality, which appeared in 1948 and 1953, or read sex-oriented bestsellers such as Grace Matalius's novel Peyton Place and Polly Adler's memoir A House Is Not a Home, published in 1953 and 1956, respectively. Playboy debuted in 1953, raising the bar for sex in magazines. Its first issue featured a nude shot of Marilyn Monroe, who was named America's top female movie star in the same year. But while sexy entertainment was widespread during the 1950s, it generally came with a look-but-don't-touch message, manifesting the need for sex and the denial of sex that coexisted in the national ethos. The don't-touch part of the message was particularly aimed at a segment of society that cares very much about sex, young people, of whom there were plenty, born in the post-war baby boom. As they grew into adolescence, they encountered many older people eager to sell them the era's popular products, from magazines, movies, and TV shows to the items advertised in them. And thus, youth culture, now cultivated by marketers as a special domain with its own folkways, mores, opportunities, and obsessions, was born. This was something new under the American sun, and there was money to be made from it. The only thing missing was a counterculture group daring enough to call its bluff and expose its lies from within the youth culture itself. Enter the Beat Generation. Recalling the Lost Generation. Like the lost generation before them, the Beats arose in the aftermath of a world war, and they saw the earlier group as a spiritual and aesthetic forerunner of their own circle, embodying a similar belief that forward-looking literature and art was an antidote to the nightmares of the past and the anxieties of the present. Also, like the Lost Generation, the Beats had a romance with a foreign land, replacing cosmopolitan Paris with wild and woolly Mexico, a place that was steeped in history, rich in mythology, and sufficiently relaxed about drugs to be a sympathetic roosting place for what William S. Burroughs called refugee hipsters. The Beat chronicler John Clellon Holmes expressed the Lost Generation worldview beautifully when he said the generation that made the Roaring Twenties roar first appeared in a roadster, laughing hysterically because nothing meant anything anymore, and went to Europe unsure about whether it wanted to find an orgiastic future or to escape from the puritanism of the past. Its attitude was one of desperate frivolity, Holmes continued, and its pervading mood was a sense of loss. One hears clear echoes of the Beats in this account, yet there were contrasts between the groups as well. The Beats built their reputations mainly in their own country, for instance, and only a few of them shared the taste for extreme intricacy and fragmentation that Joyce, Pound, and Eliot cultivated in their work. More profoundly, as Holmes pointed out, the Lost Generation was occupied with the loss of faith, religious and otherwise, whereas many Beats were preoccupied with the need for it. Or, as Kerouac put it in 1958, the Lost Generation built upon ironic romantic negation, but the Beats were sweating for affirmation, seeking absolute belief in a divinity of rapture. Hence, the religious overtones that swirl through such essential Beat texts as Ginsberg's 1961 poem Kaddish and Kerouac's 1965 novel Desolation Angels, among many others. Buddhism and Gurus. As inner-directed artists committed to the unspeakable visions of the individual, the Beats were wary of guides and gurus, even in the guru-mad 1960s when, for one example out of dozens, the Beatles made the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi into a major celebrity. Discipleship is an important part of Buddhist tradition, however, and serious Buddhists like Kerouac, Ginsberg, and Snyder were devoted to the concept of the guru as bodhisattva, less a leader or teacher than a spiritual reflection of the believer's own Buddha nature. To them, seeking and cherishing the bodhisattva, who is often found among the cast-offs of materialistic society, was a way to pursue enlightenment in the wide world and simultaneously delve deeper into the sacredness of the self. Kerouac's 1958 novel, The Dharma Bums.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.